Welcome to the Lift Podcast, where you'll discover how to achieve your goals by lifting others. I'm Richard Newman, keynote speaker, coach, author, and award-winning speechwriter. If you want to lead a more fulfilling life, this podcast will give you the tools to transform your career, mindset, and relationships. Join me and my esteemed guests as we explore the power of Lift. Hello and welcome to the Lift Podcast. I'm your host, Richard Newman, and we'll be exploring how you can achieve your goals by lifting others, which makes today's conversation incredibly important. Today, I'm really honored to have with me on the show Deepa Purushothaman. And Deepa has recently written this book that's just come out, which is called The First, The Few, and The Only, a deeply personal call to action for women of color to find power both within themselves and their communities, advocating for a new corporate environment where all belong and are accepted on their own terms. Now, if you haven't come across Deepa already, she was the first Indian woman to become a partner at Deloitte. She has degrees from Wellesley College, Harvard Kennedy School, and the London School of Economics. For her book, she interviewed over 500 women of color. Her recent TED talk on this subject has had over 700,000 views just in the first month. And Billie Jean King, who has been a champion of equity for over 50 years, said this book will help build bridges, dismantle barriers, and change how we lead in the workplace. So Deepa is on a mission to make work work for everyone. Deepa, thank you so much for being here on the show.
Thank you for having me. Excited to be here.
So there's so much that I'd love to talk about here, so many issues for us to get into. And first of all, to think about this, if you're listening into the show and you're not a woman of color, then remember that this the spirit of this podcast is about lift. It's about how we achieve goals by lifting others. So clearly, this is an opportunity to learn about the current challenges that are being faced by so many people and to talk about the better future that can be created for all of us. So maybe let's start there. So Deepa, if you can really guide us into this situation, what are the big current challenges, as you see it, that really need to be changed?
Yeah, and I love that you started with that. So if you don't mind, I just want to share. It's been really interesting as the book has come out and I'm having conversations with people. I wrote the book for women of color. I wrote the book that I wish I'd had when I'd entered the workplace and I navigated. And yes, I was successful, but I had to figure out so many things on my own because there weren't role models that looked like me before. But what's been humbling, what's been fascinating is who's picking up the book early are white readers and white leaders who want to understand what the situation is and want to really help in making change. And so although I may have naively written the book for women of color, what I'm finding is it's actually been a really helpful resource for leaders who just want to understand what is really different, what is really hard, what are we really not talking about. And so the book is in some ways, I mean, I don't love this terminology, but I think it makes it easy to understand. It's almost a business case of like, why is it really difficult for women of color in the workplace? And, you know, one of the things I talk about is how the corporate structure is not a meritocracy. We've only had permission to talk about that, I believe, in the last few years. It shows up differently for different groups. And so to think that we're all going to enter the workplace and we're going to have a similar experience if we work hard, I think sets up a lot of women of color for hardship, for illness, for many things that go untalked about. And so this book is really kind of lifting the lens on that and really showing what is different for women of color. To answer your question more directly, what's different is there's just a lot of things that we experience that aren't talked about. So I open the book with this story where I'm sitting with a friend. We're celebrating both of our promotions to partner. He's a really good friend of mine. We went to graduate school together. We both made partner in our respective firms. We're celebrating. And I share with him, I'm stressed. You know, I'm feeling the pressure of what comes next as a new partner. All eyes are on me because I am this first woman of color in this seat. And he says to me, he's a white leader, he says to me, you don't have anything to worry about. I'm a white man. I'm going to have to prove myself. You are golden because you're a twofer. You check two boxes. You have nothing to worry about. And I start with that story because he was such a good friend. And for him to say that, it wasn't malicious, but it cut me at my knees because it made me question, does he think I belong there? Is everyone else thinking I got this opportunity, not because I deserve it and I earned it, but because of these things that I represent? That's just one example of the microaggressions of the belief that we have to overcome. There's many stereotypes. There's a lot of code switching that we do. to kind of navigate spaces. And there's a lot of extra work. This is the last point. You know, there's probably 12 or 13 things, but the last point I'll share here is all the extra things that we get asked to do, all the culture building, all the mentoring, all the, you know, I love this line in the book, because so many women of color would say to me, if there was an event, they knew that they had to be picture ready, because as a woman of color, you were most likely going to have your picture taken in a room to represent the company's diversity. And so there's just many things that we get asked to take on that, you know, some take a toll, some don't, but we should talk about, because it is different. I know if we're both in a room, my picture is probably in 99.9% of the time going to be taken because of the needs of what, you know, the company wants to show.
Yeah, I think it's great that you've said that, you know, you've already had that strong reception from people who are not women of color. So a broader range of people wanting to know about the book and wanting to learn about it. I remember years ago being asked to speak at a conference which was about women in leadership. And I think there was only two male speakers on the day, which is great, and the majority being women. But I looked around the room and there was 300 people in the room. And I think, you know, including myself, there was maybe four men. And it struck me that if more men don't go to conferences like that and get involved in the conversation, then the change isn't going to happen, because the theme of it was, you know, how do you succeed in a world that is dominated by men? So it's not that the women in the room were holding back opportunities for the other women. It was that the men should have been there to listen to that conversation so they understand how things really need to be changed. And I love one of the messages that you had around your book, which is that perhaps some people are afraid that if women of color are given more opportunity, then that means that their piece of the pie is being given to somebody else. But I believe that your message around this is that actually it's all about making the pie bigger. Is that right?
Right. That is. It is. I feel like that's one of the messages, or what I call a delusion, that we've been taught, that maybe there's 12 seats at the table, but who decided that, right? Why is that the case? Why is that the norm? And so there's many of these corporate norms, corporate behaviors, things that we have been taught, I call it indoctrinated with, that I think we need to revisit because they don't really serve us. And I think I love that the book is coming out right now, because I think the last few years around COVID have made us all question, what is the place that work takes in our lives? You know, what is the importance of work? And also just bigger questions about the planet and what's right. And, you know, what value should we really place importance on in business? And so that's really what this book is about. It's really asking, yes, what is belonging? You know, how are workplaces showing up differently? But it's a lot of bigger questions about, like, what do we need as a society right now? And the things that we emphasize and the idea that there's limited seats or scarcity, or that the pie is, you know, we're just redistributing the pie, is a really broken way of thinking about things. And if we don't take this moment as we emerge from the last few years and really rethink work, when are we ever going to do that?
You're absolutely right. I hear so many people talking about that, that sense of, like, now is a moment to reshape the workplace in the way that we would love it to be for all of us, making work for everybody. So let's start to talk about, you know, what we can do. And I wanted to come back to that story that you mentioned, which starts off your book, which is, so first of all, what can we do confronting microaggressions and outdated norms, workplace misconceptions? What could people start to do tomorrow after listening to this that would start to make a better place for everybody?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing, and I'll use that story as an example, is I call the person my friend. I didn't use his real name, but I call him Walter in the book. And when Walter said that to me, I was completely caught flat-footed. And I use that term quite a bit in the book. I was caught flat-footed because I didn't know what to say. I wasn't prepared for it. I felt pain and shame, even though he was saying that to me. And I was confused, right? Like, is he undermining me? Is this a bad thing he's saying? Like, it was just a confusing situation. And now, a few years later, I think I have better words for it and understand it better. But in the moment, I was caught off guard. And so my feedback to women of color, and also to allies, who I call co-conspirators, by the way, because I want them to not just be watching or say they're an ally, I want them to really get involved and do work as well, is it's all of our work to change cultures. So I ask women of color to have three things that they can practice and say when something comes up, because I want women of color to know that racism, microaggressions are going to happen. It's naive to think that they won't. So saying things like, that really offended me. Period. You don't need to say anything else. That really doesn't work for me. You know, that really hurt me. Can I explain why? you know, just whatever works for you. It doesn't have to be those three things, but three practice things so that when you get caught in the moment, you are not shocked. You're not overwhelmed by emotion. I also tell women of color to pause. You know, you can't react to every single thing that feels wrong because that is not helpful in the workplace and you have to pick your battles. And so I have this rule or this test that I've come up with where if something bothers me for more than 10 minutes, so let's say someone says something and it's, you know, it's not great. I don't love it, but I also, we're in the middle of a meeting or it's not super important for me that I feel like I need to intervene, I wait 10 minutes. And if in 10 minutes I still feel like that butterfly feeling in my stomach or that queasy feeling in my gut, I know I'm going to worry about it the rest of the day. I know that really was an offensive comment. And I pause the meeting and I say something about it. But I don't necessarily do that with everything. But what's interesting is I want allies and co-conspirators to do that too. You're going to witness things that are said that are not appropriate, whether it's on Zoom or whether it's in the room. And I want you to also practice saying, I'm not sure that that was the right thing to say. Do you know that that probably was offensive? You know, we need to pause and talk about what you just said. So same three things, whatever works for you, so that you also can stop and intervene in a moment that is racist or uncomfortable or a microaggression sort of situation. We don't teach people that. We don't actually think about what are we going to do when it happens, because we all want to believe it's not going to happen. And then, you know, the incident happens and 20 minutes later or the next day, we're talking about it at the water cooler or saying, can you believe that person just said that? And if we could actually find ways to intervene in the moment and realize there are ways to do it that can be helpful, there are ways that don't make the other person necessarily feel completely belittled, you know, but it's also up to us to take care of ourselves. And that's what I'm trying to teach women of color, but I also want allies to understand it's all of our work to change culture, to your point. I can't do it by myself. We all have to do it together.
Yeah, I really like this 10-minute rule of if something has made you feel uncomfortable, just give it a minute. But you're not saying, you know, give it a week. I think it's key that then, as you say, you address it in the time and place that it's happened. And so good that you're saying, you know, that sense of doing it with compassion in a way that is helpful. You're not belittling the person, saying you may not realize, but this is the situation. So a really wonderful way to address that. Now, I understand also from the book that that in the work that you did in getting to the position that you had as a partner at Deloitte, that actually by dealing with all of these workplace misconceptions, the microaggressions, everything you had to overcome to get to where you were, that you then became sick and exhausted and feeling disempowered in the process. So what was that actually like for you, that situation?
Yeah, so the situation I talk about in the book, and you know, it's really what made me leave my career and start a whole new career. And I should also say it's relatively new. So I left a year and a half ago. So I left during COVID, which is a fascinating time to decide you're going to rewrite your life, and it's possible. I want to make note of that. But I had moved across the country. I had just gotten married, so I lived on the East Coast of the U.S. and I'd moved to the West Coast. So it was a pretty large move. I had moved from the telecom sector to the tech sector because the West Coast in San Francisco is very tech heavy. And I ended up on the biggest project of my life. I sold the biggest project of my life 3 weeks after I got married. So really fascinating time and in an already sort of intense sort of career. And here I am delivering the biggest project of my life, 12 hours a day, you know, sometimes 14, 20 hours a day easily. And the intensity of it was overwhelming. In addition, I had already been asking bigger questions around my purpose. Again, I had a great career, but I had 20 years in front of me. And I didn't go to a graduate school thinking I was going to be, you know, in corporate. I actually, my background was more politics and policy and wanting to make change. And so, you know, I had this nexus of, am I living my purpose? All of a sudden, I'm working 20 hours a day for 8 months and I'm really burnt out. And my body started to react. So it started as small things like headaches and skin rashes. And over the course of a couple of years, it really turned into a growing list of issues. And I tell a story in the book where I'd seen my 14th doctor and she said to me, you know, your job is killing you. And you know, not literally that your job is killing you, but what she was trying to say to me is I lived out of a suitcase. I sometimes did three cities a week. I ate you know, whatever I could eat, whenever I could eat. I traveled all the time, you know, on an airplane. It just wasn't conducive to healing. My body had slowly been telling me, you're taxing yourself. And here I was not really listening. And so those issues really manifested. And so I ended up taking 8 months off. I ended up, you know, I didn't leave right away. I took the 8 months off to try and heal. I sought out a lot of alternative healers because my issues kept manifesting into changing and morphing challenges. I ended up getting a late stage Lyme diagnosis, you know, 15 doctors later, which is hard to diagnose and has these morphing, it's like a chronic illness, right? These morphing symptoms. But part of, I think, the message I want people to hear is that I didn't prioritize my wellness. Like for me, success was doing well. And part of what I learned through my process is success can't come at the cost of health, right? Our work lives can't come at the cost of health. And I think for women of color, you know, what I've learned in all these interviews is that all these things that we navigate, being a first, being an only, representing our entire race. There's a woman I met in the book. She works in a Midwestern company in the United States. And she said she's the only Black person in her company. And she actually said she believes she's the only Black person many people in the company have ever met. And as she told me, she started to have tears and her voice got choked up because she said, you don't understand what that means. Like, I literally worry about what I look like, how my hair is, how I talk, what I eat, how I dress, what I talk about, because I feel like I'm representing my whole race. And so think about that. Like, that's not part of her job description. That is not what she was hired to do. And she literally has decided that, you know, it has been ingrained in her. That's her responsibility. And so I share that because there is burnout. There are challenges that come with those extra responsibilities that we don't talk about. And what I have found in the women of color I'm meeting with is that that has moved. So ever since George Floyd's murder in the U.S., at least, there is a different dialogue happening on race, and especially starting to happen around race at work. We're acknowledging racism is real. You know, in all candor, I think up until a few years ago, there was a denial that it was happening. You know, in small pockets, people would talk about it. But for the most part, there was kind of an idea of, well, we're not a racist society. We just, you know, it happens in small areas or small pockets. And what I have found from talking to psychologists and talking to all these women of color is that they are going through something where they're feeling the racism. So up till now, they've never acknowledged it. Once you actually acknowledge it emotionally, there's something else that happens in your body where you actually feel it, and you have to go through the process of letting it go before you get better. I think that's the phase we're in. A lot of the trauma we're talking about has probably been there for a very long time. The difference that we're facing right now is that women of color are giving themselves permission to acknowledge it. Other people are seeing it. They're being witnessed. And so we're feeling it in our bodies. And so that's really the moment I think that we're in that we need to understand. I don't believe that will last forever. I do think, you know, I don't think the racism is going away, but I think that we'll find better ways to process it, to let it out of our bodies. We'll be better at talking about it. It's all really new. You know, for a long time, I grew up being told, you know, if you work hard, everything will be okay. That's not the truth. And that's a hard, you know, hard lesson to kind of come to terms with.
Yeah, I think it's so important what you said about when you acknowledge something is there, you feel it more, and only then really can you begin that process to heal that situation and get through that. And I wanted to come back to this situation of wanting to take 8 months away from work and try to navigate that piece, because you mentioned that you're traveling a lot and eating on the fly and living that lifestyle. But also, I think you mentioned in the book that there's the additional weight, as you mentioned there, feeling like you have to represent your race, but also that need to fit in with expectations and live in a world that is actually set up for white men rather than the way that life could be. So there's that extra weight that you're having to deal with. I like the analogy that you've given around luggage on an airplane. Mm-hmm. If you could talk about that piece.
Yes.
And because it's absolutely such an important one.
Mm-hmm. I start with this in the book because I still feel like it's hard for people to understand the concept that corporate America is not a meritocracy, that it does show up differently. And I understand why that's hard, because we've never really talked about it. So the story I tell in the book is that I sat down with Renee Myers. She's a Black woman. She's the VP of inclusion at Netflix. She's a good friend of mine. And we were chatting and I was just interviewing her like I interviewed everyone else. But when I asked her a few questions, she started talking about airplane design. And she said, you know, she said she's taller than I am. So I'm 5'1", she's 5'6", 5'7". And she said, I really worry about when I get on a plane, you know, how the luggage is overhead. And when I had younger children, it would be something I would really worry about. Like, is the luggage going to fall on my children? And I used to always think, why do they design airplanes with the stowage overhead? Well, as soon as she shared that, I shared with her, I'm 5'1". And so putting the luggage overhead is something I stress about 15 minutes before I get on the airplane. I'm usually sweating by the time I'm sitting in my seat. It's very stressful to get it out after because everyone's in a hurry. I can usually barely reach. It's a process. And the reason that story is important is because the gentleman sitting next to me who might be 5'10 or taller is not thinking about those things. And so it's a great example of she's a Black woman. She's thinking about her children. I'm a short Indian woman. I'm thinking about like the height. And here's this white man sitting next to me who's maybe not thinking about any of those things. And the point is that within a few minutes of getting on the airplane, we're having different experiences. And that applies to the workplace too. So if we don't acknowledge that the stowage is different for all of us, that first 15 minutes makes me feel innately like I don't belong, right? There's something wrong with me. I'm too short versus why did they not contemplate the fact that that's not an easy process for everybody? That's the same around the workplace. It shows up differently for me than it will for you. And that's just how it is. And part of what we talked about and what I talk about in the book is I did some research, right? The number of women who were actually designing airplanes when that came into practice was only 2 or 3%. And so we weren't in the seats designing, and that is part of the flaw. And that same sort of philosophy applies to the workplace as well. We weren't there when it was designed. Women of color were not in the seats. Women weren't in the seats. The model of corporate America is still based on a two-parent household where one is working and one is staying home raising the children. It's usually a man and a woman. That model is outdated and we have never redone it. And so I'm just also suggesting that as we remake it, we need to acknowledge the workplace never contemplated me rising in it. It never contemplated me sitting in those seats. And the message I sometimes got formally, informally from the media around me, from the clients I served, was that leadership didn't look like me. I can't tell you how many times I would walk into a meeting, even as a senior partner, and they would look at the white gentleman and just assume I was there to take notes or I was the junior person because I always looked young for my age, literally every single time. And so yes, that doesn't stop me from doing my job, but think about the confidence that you have to literally on a monthly basis or every time I would start with a new client, have to explain, yes, like here are my degrees, here's my background, here's why I'm here. It takes its toll. And so those are the things we don't talk about and how the workplace shows up differently. And I love the airplane analogy because until she said it to me, that is something that really stresses me out, you know, getting the luggage in the overhead.
And I found it incredible to read it as well, because, you know, I want to acknowledge I'm a white male, 6'3". And I used to, before the pandemic, I would take 50 flights per year to go and see our clients around the world. I had never once thought about putting my luggage or worrying about putting my luggage up. I would look around to see if anybody needed some help, but I'd never had to worry about it. And I think that it's such a great analogy to look at as we are in this conversation in general of how do we rebuild the future of work so that it works for everybody, that it's so important, as you say, to bring in the voices of people that we want to be working with from diverse backgrounds to say, what is going to make the design of this actually work for everybody? Because if we're not doing that, then that's actually making the future of work worse for everybody if we haven't brought those voices into that conversation. And I wanted to ask you about, because this important piece around, you know, needing to fit in the workplace based on norms that have been there in the past. You've also mentioned that sort of around that piece of the lean in mentality that can leave women and women of color feeling burnt out or isolated. I wanted to get your reflections on Sheryl Sandberg's message of lean in. And what are your thoughts on that?
You know, I read the book when it first came out, literally like within 24 hours, because most women I knew in corporate were waiting for that book. And I read it and it just didn't work for me. It didn't fit for me. You know, I didn't have a stronger reaction as some others have had. I just kind of read it and I just said, well, that doesn't always work. And again, I don't know that I had the words. I think the part that is missing in that book is the structure, right? Is the fact that it is different. So I can lean in as hard as I want. But if I get someone who just doesn't see me as a leader, who because of his own biases or her own biases, isn't going to make space for me, I can lean in and overwork myself. And that is actually something I found with almost all of the women of color I interviewed. So a lot of the Black women I interviewed were taught from childhood to work two or four times as hard to get, you know, just as far. A lot of the immigrant women were taught, keep your head down and work super hard and, you know, you'll get ahead. It's slightly different messages, but the message of work. And there is a real predominance with these women who are super successful, myself included, where you have to overwork yourself just to get taken seriously. And that to me was the lean in message, just, you know, just lean in, work harder. And the other part of the research that I found that was really shocking was the conforming, the amount of conforming we do without really labeling it conforming. And so many of the senior women of color I met thought wrongly, women of color, once I get to the seat, I will do it my way. I mean, I thought that too. Like I'll be more myself once I get senior. And I always was a little bit more myself because I never thought I'd be in corporate forever. I was a little bit of a rebel rouser. But a lot of the women of color I met thought I'll get to the seat. The problem is once you get to the seat, there's even more expectation that you're going to conform. There's more expectation you're going to uphold the company, you know, motto that you're going to do how it was because you had done and you had conformed to get to the seat. So why would you change now? And so there's this real values conflict. There's so many women of color who believe like I'll get there and then I'll change how I am. I'll bring in all my pictures. I'll dress differently. I'll do all these, whether those are small things or big things. And they just find once they get to the seat, it's really challenging. A few I met have been able to. There's a woman I interviewed who was a chief inclusion officer at a big medical company. And her way of doing that once she got to the seat was really bringing and talking about underserved markets in the medical space, right? And so she's like, I didn't necessarily dress differently or show up differently. But what I did was I brought topics that were important to my community to the seat that I sat in. And so there are ways to do it, but the actual day-to-day conforming, most of the women of color I interviewed really don't know how to navigate that because there is such a pressure and there's such a belief that leadership looks a certain way. That's what this book is about. It's really talking about if we continue to think leadership looks a certain way, we're doing a disservice to all of us because I think there's such rich history. I think there's such amazing lived experiences of women of color that we're denying if we're saying that leadership can only look like these three criteria. And that's really what we need to unpack and change.
Yeah, I like what you mentioned earlier about previously not having role models that looked like you and therefore sort of fitting the norm of what needed to be done to get to where you were. And then the pressure that you find when you get there of not only that you have to fit in with those norms, but if you've overworked to get there to sort of prove yourself, then the expectation is, well, you have to keep doing that. That's why we've put you here. I like the quote that you've given that I'd read, which is we've got to figure out for ourselves what makes us feel powerful rather than using the playbook most of us been handed growing up and around the corporate spaces. So can I ask you about that? So what is it that, how would you like to see the future? What do you think would help more people, more women of color feel powerful rather than the way things have been done in the past? What a shift. If there's a leader listening to this thinking we have to make changes, what are the big changes you'd like to start seeing?
Yeah, so I'll answer it for both groups. So for women of color, what I want us to understand is that we have agency and that every time that you choose to conform, and it's a choice, I'm not saying you can not conform and every culture will reward you, but it is a choice. And I want us to understand that. I'm not, by the way, I think in a lot of cases you are going to have to conform, but I want you to understand that you're doing it. I think why these women of color I interviewed and myself included felt like we weren't in power once we were sitting in seats of power is because we didn't understand that was happening to us. And so just understanding that you have agency in small ways. So for the less tenured women, it was things like, what do I wear and can I wear red lipstick? That was literally one of the questions that one of the women brought up. She said, I don't know if I'll be taken seriously if I do that. Am I allowed to do that? So that's one end of the spectrum, all the way to if I see something that's inappropriate as a senior person, does it behoove me to report? Because by the way, a lot of company structures aren't set up to actually address racism. There is actually backlash when you report right now. And we can talk about that if we want to. So I think for women of color, it's understanding we have agency and that what happens to a lot of people is they believe later down the line as women of color, then I'll find my power. And I want us to understand it is a daily practice. It is a daily process. How you come into the corporate space will most likely also be how you leave it. And so be really conscious of that. And, you know, I talk about how to do that and what to do in the book. I also want to say you can't do it every single time. So I'm not suggesting, you know, question everything, push on everything and do whatever you want, because that's also not going to serve you. But just to really be thoughtful in these choice points is really what I'm talking about. for allies and companies, I think we have to listen differently. You know, so many of the CEOs I've sat down with will say to me, well, my people of color tell me the truth. If I ask them what it's like to be a Black employee, they tell me. And I will go meet with their Black employees or their women of color 2 hours later, and I get a whole different story. There isn't a reward right now for honestly telling your truth. A lot of women of color are truth tellers, but the system kind of bites back. And so we really need to look at how we create space to share our truths, how we listen, what we do with that information. And I think we need to really look at how reporting processes and HR processes so that there is more space in the system to speak up about things that aren't working. Like right now, there's a lot of practices in place to protect the company, not necessarily protect the woman of color when she raises issues. And that's the problem that we have. Like, I think we're in transition. I don't think all companies are bad, but I think we're in this moment where there's still company protection. There's still, you know, we're trying to do the right thing, but we don't have the right processes in place to actually address racism. That's the fundamental challenge we have.
Yeah, that's a really key message of that sense of so many things are there to protect the company for the, you know, the shareholders or whoever it's they're protecting it for, and not protecting the person. And I think that's what's so powerful about this moment is, you know, with the mass resignation that happened across the America and other places of people saying, look, why am I even here? What am I doing this for? What is my life going to be about? What is the purpose of this organization? And I believe that, you know, we're in this space where people want to have that change and see that the processes are there to protect the person. And it's not about just the numbers and the profitability, but it's about humanity and choosing who we want to be as people. You mentioned there about the backlash that can happen from reporting the challenges that exist. Can you mention a bit more about that so people are more aware?
Yeah. So, you know, there's one chapter in the book that is solely dedicated to how processes are broken. And I ended up meeting with at least a dozen senior women. When I say senior, I mean VP level and higher, so C-suite women. And those women had encountered some real egregious issues, some racist incident, whether it was their own or they had seen it in the company. And, you know, they were senior, they had been supported, so they felt like they had full ability to speak their truth and to file a complaint and do all of the things that they had been told the company was set up to do. And most of these women, when they ended up filing a complaint or, you know, going to HR and saying there's a problem, this person has really done something racist and we need to look at it, we need to actually do an investigation. The women, literally all of them, ended up in a really difficult situation, and most of them, almost 11 out of the 12, ended up leaving their companies and being pushed out even the industry because they made a big stink. You know, they basically were reporting the truth but talking about a racist incident with companies that just weren't prepared to take that action. And so my message to companies and to leaders is we may all believe we have processes in place. We may all believe that when a racist incident happens, we will take action. But I'm telling you, I have the data to suggest that that's not true. I met with an investigator. So she actually used to do investigations for the NFL. And she now has her own firm. Her name is Kia. And she was sharing with me that companies just don't have the data. They just don't look at the data in the right ways. And most of them use internal people to investigate these wrongdoings. And those internal people aren't necessarily those internal people don't necessarily have the understanding of how to investigate racism. They haven't been taught that. This is a new field. And so she ends up finding like there might be intent for the company to do the right thing, but they don't even know what to look at. They don't know how to, you know, ask the woman, ask the person, like what has happened. So it's a really difficult, broken system right now. And so that's really what I'm talking about is if we're actually pushing on people who tell the truth, who are actually asking people to, you know, report incidents of racism, and there's complete backlash where these women are leaving the workplace as a result of reporting, there seems to be something wrong with the system. And so it just happened too many times for it to be a one-off. And so that my message is the processes are broken and that there is real retaliation that seems to happen when women speak up about racism. We need to keep doing it, but we also need to acknowledge that we don't make it easy for us to talk about it.
Yeah, and to talk about that subject of, you know, how easy is it really to raise this? I wondered sort of as an outsider looking in on the situation about comparisons between this situation and the Me Too movement, where for Me Too, it seemed to raise that opportunity for the women to say, hey, actually, this happened to me too, where it seemed before that the things had happened, but nobody was really sharing that story. Even women were not sharing that story with other women. So they felt very much isolated. Do you see that being the same for women of color in the workplace with like the microaggressions, the challenges they go through? Is there a sense of like not knowing who to share it with or feeling that it's only them? And maybe this is a moment for people to understand how widespread that situation is.
Yeah, it's a great question. I've thought about that a lot. Like, why haven't we had the Me Too movement, you know, in this space? I think it's coming, to be honest with you. I think it's just so new that people still are not clear on how to talk about it. You know, there's still confusion over what is a microaggression versus what is racism. And people are still trying to interpret how much is too much. So I think we're there. I think it's a little bit more confusing. I also think it has to do with race and how we see race, right? Just the shame and pain we have around it. So I don't know that we have the vocabulary. And a lot of the women of color I met were taught to ignore it, that that's just how it is and to keep going, right? Literally, like just grind through it. And so we have, I think there's a different message around it. I do think we'll hit that point where those stories are being told. So many of the women I also met were under NDAs. And so that's same, the same is true of the Me Too movement. And there had to be a breakthrough in some of those spaces. But almost all the women in the story I told you about, these dozen women, they all were under NDAs to not be able to talk about their stories, you know, officially. So it was all kind of, I got very, you know, I got the details, but I had to go and mask kind of who the company was and all of their stories as a result of that. So I think there's more protectionism around reporting on these topics than there might have even been around Me Too. That's my belief. I also just think we don't have the language, and I think we are going to get to that tipping point. I think we're starting to see it. You know, in the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal last year, there was a number of pieces talking about, you know, racist incidents in a way that I'd never seen before. So I do think as media and as more people tell their stories, I think it'll happen and we'll see more. But I also think a lot of women of color, when it comes up, are just going and starting their own companies and just saying, I'm not going to deal with it anymore. And that's why you're seeing this spike in the number of women of color, especially Black women-owned companies right now, because it's true. We're now acknowledging it. We're feeling it in our bodies and we're leaving. So,
yeah. Well, it's a shame that they're having feeling that they have to leave, but it's also a brilliant thing that they can then shape the future and shape a company in the way that they would like to see that. And I wonder for people who, maybe if there's someone listening thinking, we've got to get better at this conversation. Are there certain things people can do about creating a safe opportunity for the conversation to take place in their workplace to create a better sense of equity for everybody who's there? What's the right way forward for that?
Yeah. You know, I think it's complicated. And I should say at the outset, not all companies are created equally. So some do it better, you know, and some want to believe they have processes and they don't. So part of what I really encourage women of color to do is to really take stock of the company they're in and understand their culture, because some places are, you just can't report like the immediate backlash to it. They'll call it a transparent process, but within 24 hours, everyone knows that a complaint has been filed. You have to understand your culture. I think the other thing that we really have to do if we're going to change it is not make it just the women of color's responsibility to report, right? So one of the things I do ask co-conspirators to do is, you know, you take that responsibility. If you think your company is actually going to take action and is set up to not retaliate, you know, don't do it to the woman of color, but that can be something you take on. Like, why is it something that I have to do? And so it's a little bit of all of us using the system and understanding the system. There's also a really interesting story that I had never really thought about. And Kia, the woman I met, brought this up. She said to me, think about when you first, you know, hired or interviewed with your company and accepted the role. She said, most places will tell you where IT is. They'll go through a really detailed process of what to do if your computer breaks down or if you need a new ID badge. But she said, very rarely will you understand or be told where the processes are for HR. You'll get an email or you'll be told we have a warm hotline, but you don't actually necessarily meet the HR people. You don't go through a rigorous process. You're not really told what to do if something comes up. And isn't that really fascinating that the things that we probably need are not really talked about? They're there. I'm not saying they don't exist, but we just don't even know how to use them, and we're not really sure. There's mystery around them. So I think part of this is demystifying that process a little bit more. And also just really understanding that there's not a reward for a lot of women of color telling their truth. And so we have to find a new way and a new culture that we can unearth racism, that we can talk about these things. Because again, we talked about the fact that we're already traumatized. This is an extra thing to take on. Think about the stress when you report something like this. Think about, you know, all the worry you have around backlash. These women ended up getting really sick. These women ended up in year-long processes of arbitration and other things. It's not a small task to take on. And so that's part of it too. It's just really looking at that and understanding what these women have actually sacrificed to actually try and do the right thing and the bite back that happens with that.
And I like what you're saying there about, you know, that the co-conspirators getting involved to maybe be the reporters of that. Did I read somewhere that you were saying that It's a good idea to create a sponsor program where you can have a sponsor who perhaps is therefore feeling like it's their responsibility to make sure that you succeed, you get ahead, and the right things are reported. Is that a possible path forward if people are thinking, well, how do we make this situation better to make sure that there are sponsors in place within organizations?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I've talked about quite a bit, and in maybe less in the book, but I definitely have talked about it, you know, when I've told stories, is that I've had amazing sponsors during my career, and they were usually white men because of those were the people who before me were sitting in seats of power. And they've been really helpful to me. And there were a few that when things would come up, I would talk to them and I'd get their advice. I think we do need people like that. We need people that are looking out for women of color. We need people who understand and can relate. So much of the data that I found suggests that we only tend to sponsor and support people who look like us because we have a level of comfort with people who look like us. That happens in the hiring process, that happens in the advancement process, and it happens in the sponsorship process. So it's really important that we find ways to connect with people as individuals, that you and I probably have a lot in common. We may not see that on face value, but if we actually can have a meal together, I'm sure we can find things that we have in common. So yes. At the same time, I think it's really hard on topics like this because sponsors don't always understand the issues that women of color face. So I you know, have heard a few stories where sponsors have told women of color, go report or I'll help you do this thing without realizing that the system does have challenges, that there is retaliation. And so it's just the sensitivity, again, to the fact that the experience of women of color is different. And as a white male sponsor, you may experience the system in a different way and not be aware of the bias and the challenges that exist. And so I think those sponsors are absolutely important, but also, you know, I think on issues of reporting, there's many more conversations. And what I tell women to do is to find outside counsel, is to find outside sources, is to find other ways to have some of this conversation and get advice and support too.
Hmm. Well, it feels like there's so many things that can be done here for people who are in leadership positions or powerful positions, so much that they can be doing to lift others to create a better future for everyone. I wanted to ask you in terms of if people are listening to this, whether that's women of color or other people who are just having so many challenges that they're facing, what is it that you'd advise people to lift themselves if they're feeling in a terrible state, they're facing so many challenges? What have you done? What have you found useful to overcome challenging days, difficult moments, emotional, upsetting moments, to bring then your best self and still be able to thrive? What do you find helps you thrive in those situations?
Absolutely. And I feel like I need to say, like, the book is a very optimistic book. So it does paint a picture of a difficult situation, but it ends in a place where we do have power to make change. And again, like we talked about, if we're ever going to make it, now feels like the moment, and that women of color are stepping into new kinds of leadership and more opportunities and more things are being presented to us than ever before. So it's a very exciting moment in that sort of way. I think what we just need to get better at is understanding the context, is really making space to have the discussions. And what I really want us to do as women of color is to find others and to find allies. And so I talk a little bit in the book about this idea of the power of me and the power of we. So this idea that there is work that you can do for yourself to find agency, to find power, to kind of get rid of messages that don't serve you, that maybe came from childhood, and reprogram that with messages that do serve you. But then a lot of this work is about finding others, finding other women of color. I mentioned the dinners that I did. That really was about community. It was about finding other people to be witnessed in what was happening, to realize it was not me. And when you know it's not you and it's, you know, happening around you, it frees you. There's a sense of liberation that happens. So part of what I really need women of color and co-conspirators and allies to do is to really form communities on their own and to have conversations like this. How is race showing up in the workplace? What can you do about it? When something happens, you know, women of color need to have other people they can share the story with. You know, the data I found suggests that we hold on to negative stories four times as often as positive stories. And so those microaggressions will play over and over and over again. But if you have, even just a chat group of four other women of color that you can say, this just happened, what would you do? And they can just be there to hear you and to share their ideas. It does free us and allows our body to process back to that idea of the body holding and storing, you know, pain and shame. It allows us to process those things. So I think it's so important to figure out what support mechanisms you need and not to underestimate the fact that we are just getting comfortable talking about these topics and we need to have community to be able to work through them, to change them, and to really process them.
Yeah. And I think you're so right to say that you have got a really inspiring message to share and an uplifting vision of, you know, how much better the future could be. I think there's so many inspiring messages that you share just on an individual level of along the lines of saying, you know, you don't have to see it in order to be it, to become, you know, be the role model that you wish that you had if you don't have those at the moment. And I also love the message you have, which is one of your rules, where you said nothing about what exists can't be changed. So the final rule is that together we can remake anything that has come before. Such a powerful message for people of all ages to be thinking about, you know, what, how would they like to see the world and what can they do tomorrow to make it that way? And I also love the message I wanted to share, which is you said how to play the game, thinking about how to play the game while you change the game. So it's that there's two pieces. You've got to have that future vision, but you also got to know, you know, how are you going to play the game today, day after day, to get there. So is there any other thoughts you'd like to share with people on that, about if they've got a great vision about how they wanted to change the future, elements that are going to help them play the game on the way there to change the game?
Yeah, that's a chapter I really didn't want to write because I really wanted to talk about how the structure needed to change. But deep in my process, I got feedback that I had to really think about the fact that, you know, not everyone can quit right away and walk out of the structures and the systems that we're in. We all need jobs. And so while we're in the jobs, how do we preserve our health and our wellness and navigate spaces? So I do suggest, you know, some strategies that you can do when you're less tenured, strategies you can do when you're more tenured. And I share the stories of a few very senior women who've navigated and how they evolved their thinking during their rise, right? Some of the lessons late, like when you're early in your career, you're really just trying to understand what are the norms of the company. So I kind of lay out some ideas you can do to actually understand what the norms are in your company so that you're not figuring it out. Because part of the challenge of being a first few and only is many of us don't have others in our family who've come before us, who've even lived, you know, worked in these professional settings or have been lawyers or have been, you know, like consultants. No one in my family had done that before. So whereas some of the other colleagues that I had parents in the space or had brothers or sisters in the space, I didn't have that. And so I was figuring out things and norms, even just what the job was on its own by myself. And so it's really kind of figuring out the culture. In the middle of your career, there's a lot of pressure on family. There's a lot of pressure around caretaking that just happens because you're in that life cycle stage of your career. And so it's different questions and it's really about boundary setting. You know, how do you actually take on more? How do you really step into being a manager of others when women of color are sometimes, you know, their abilities around that space are questioned. So I give some strategies around that. And at the senior level, you know, as women of color are thinking about what's next in retirement or these, you know, C-level positions, you know, there's a lot of data that suggests we don't advocate for ourselves and we don't really negotiate for what we need. So I talk about some examples of how to negotiate for your worth. We negotiate in very different ways because we've been taught to just be happy with what we're given and to be grateful for having a seat at the table. And that doesn't serve us in this time and age. And so I give some strategies around that. So yeah, I think it's really important. We realize you can change, you know, if you're in a corporate role, you can change what's happening around you in small ways. And that is empowering. At the same time, we can work on the system from the outside and people like me who've left can help with that. And there's other ways you can do that even while you're in companies. But yeah, the overall message I think is really about the fact that we have been taught that success looks a certain way, leadership looks a certain way, and power is something, you know, that looks a certain way, and power is top down and power is competitive and power, you know, can take from people. And what I want us to realize is there's a new way to do power. There's a new way to think about the world and to think about business. And I believe women of color inherently have some of these philosophies and these beliefs from the women that I met because we've always been pushed out in some of these spaces. And so there is a way to do collective power differently. And that's really what I'm asking us to do, because I just don't think the way we're doing business serves any of us. And whether we're women of color or you, it's not working for any of us. So it's time to question all of those principles.
Yes, I think there was a message in the TED Talk, which references some of what you've said there about, you know, if we're going to achieve greater results in business, that hiring more women of color can be your greatest competitive advantage because they've had to overcome so much that their ability with their cultural competency, their emotional intelligence, their leadership ability, they've got so much to offer. So it's critical to give them an opportunity. And you also mentioned that, you know, when you had a seat at the table and you were concerned about, well, if I leave this table, then what am I going to do to lift the women of color who might want to come up beyond me, after me, then I think that certainly from hearing, you know, what you've been doing ever since and the book that you've created here, that actually making that decision to move on gives you that ability to lift even more people, you know, far beyond where you were. So I think it's an incredible message that you've got. The TED Talk is fantastic. Everybody should go and check that out. And also go and grab a copy of the book, The First, The Few, The Only. Deepa, if people want to keep in touch with you after listening to the podcast, where's the best place for them to find you?
Yes, so it would be my website. So Deepa Puru, DeepaPuru.com. And all the information about the book, about the speaking, and even about information is there, and would look forward and would love to stay in touch.
Great. Thank you so much. So if you enjoyed today's show, I encourage you, go and grab the book, stay in touch with Deepa, find out more about this, and see what you can do to lift others and to create a better future for everybody. I've really enjoyed this conversation. I hope you have, and I'll see you on the next episode of the Lift podcast.